Good morning. You look marvelous today. Thanks for being here. Pray with me, please. What a joy it is to be together, Father, in your family room. What a joy it is to sing and to give and to love one another, to experience community, life together. What a joy it is to open the Bible and to have you speak to us. I give this time, Holy Spirit, to you. I need you to be in control. So speak, I pray. And for those who are listening, I pray for all distractions to be removed. Give us ears to hear, I pray. And I give this time to you in Jesus' name. Amen. So a few weeks ago, I shared with you about a young man that I met in Vancouver, Tofino on Vancouver Island. Called him Jimmy. It's not his real name. And Jimmy's a fine young man. I met him at a coffee shop one morning. He had a black golden doodle. Black golden doodle. I didn't know they had black golden doodles. Gorgeous dog. I talked to him about the dog, and we got into a conversation. He was passionate about community. We had a great talk about that. As I was getting up to leave, he said, "Hey, Pete, can we stay in touch?" I said, "Absolutely." We exchanged email addresses, and we become pen pals, and we've been writing back and forth. A few weeks ago, he asked me the question, "What is it that gives you your fire for community?" And I took that opportunity to walk him through why I'm so passionate about true community. And I started with what I believe. And I told him, I said, you know, in order for you to understand my passion for community, you need to understand what I believe. And this is how I started my email to him. I believe that God is three in one. The theological term is the Trinity. He is one God in three persons, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. The Father, Son, and Spirit all live in perfect community, full of love, always have, always will. Not only that, I believe that every person on the planet is made in the image of God. He has planted his nature in us. And along with this, he has embedded in all human beings a longing for community. First with him, he wants us to be in his circle. And then with others, he wants us to be in a circle. For us, that's the church. This is why you want this so badly, because you're made in the image of God, I told him. I then went on to point out the fall and the fact that originally the humans that were created had this type of community with God, walking with him in the garden every day, and with each other in deep, intimate relationships. But then sin entered the world and fractured all of that, messed it up. God, because he loves us so deeply, wanted to rectify that. And so he sent his son, and I told him about Christ, and I told him about the cross, and I told him about the resurrection. I mean, I just told him all of this. And then I asked him when I was finished, "Do you have any questions?" And I pushed send. Crickets for 2 weeks. Nothing. Which wasn't all that unusual. We usually have some lag time between our communique, so I just waited, thinking I might hear back from him, but I didn't. And so Libby encouraged me one day, "Why don't you just reach out to him?" I thought, yeah, I need to do that. And so I just whipped him an email and said, "Hey, buddy, I sent you an email a couple of weeks ago. I think one of two things happened. Either it got lost in cyberspace, or you read it and you think I've lost my mind and you want nothing to do with me. Let me know which one it is." You know, he writes back, "Oh, Pete, I'm so sorry. I read it and I just have been so busy. I didn't get a chance to respond to you. I'll email you tonight." He emails me that night. Very graciously says, "I've read your email multiple times. And yeah, I do have a question." And here was his question. Now remember, I talked about the fall and I talked about Jesus and the cross and the resurrection and the Trinity, some like major theological ideas. But this was his question, quote, "I've had some conversations with others in regards to religion, and I'm curious what your opinion is on individuals who have beliefs other than what you believe." I think this is an important topic because we live in such a world of diversity and differing perspectives, and I love trying to figure out how to hold space and bring people together with different beliefs and perspectives while still showing respect, end quote. It's a beautiful question. It's a question that many millennials are asking today. Not just millennials, a bunch of old folks like us are asking it too. What about the people who don't believe the same things you believe? Can we just all get along? How can we get along? It's a great question. And so I whipped an email back to him and said, it's an awesome question. I need to think on this and noodle it, and I'll get my response back to you soon. And what I feel led to do and what I've decided to do is share my response with my friend in my sermon today. So I'm talking to you. I'm going to send him the link to this message this week and ask him to watch it. So, hey, buddy, I don't know if this is weird for you or not, but there's a handful of other people that are going to be listening in, but it's good that you're listening in for two reasons. Number one, because some of you have this exact same question. And number two, because if you don't have this question, there are lots of people very close to you who do. And so maybe this will be helpful for you to try to figure out how to navigate this conversation. So I answer the question for my friend today. What is your opinion on individuals who have beliefs other than what you believe? The first thing I want to say is I try to avoid opinions on things of eternal significance. I think opinions are fine on things like fashion. I mean, look around the room. People have different tastes as far as fashion is concerned. Am I right? That's fine. It's your opinion. It's my opinion. Food. Food is, by definition, a matter of taste. Your tastes are different from mine. It's an opinion thing. Football. There are actually people in this room that think the Cowboys are going to win the Super Bowl. That is their opinion. Opinion, by definition, is a firm conviction not necessarily based on fact. That's what an opinion is. And so because it's not necessarily based on fact, I don't like to have opinions about things of eternal significance. So what I would much rather do for you is I'd much rather tell you what the Bible says about people. What God thinks about people. Because honestly, that's much more important than what I think, and I think will be more helpful to you. Two things. The first is that they, these people that you describe, are passionately loved by God. That's the first thing I want you to hear. This is clear in Scripture. There's a number of passages I could point you to, but one that's very simple. It's a summary of the whole Bible. It's in John's Gospel in the third chapter, and it simply goes like this. For God so loved the world. God loved the world so much. Now, you could take that word world, and you could put any group of people in there that you want, because it literally means the entire world. It means every people group, every ideology, every group of people. So you could say, for God so loved the Hindus, for God so loved the Muslims, for God so loved the Mormons, for God so loved the Buddhists, for God so loved the antagonistic humanists, for God so loved everyone. The thing that the Bible teaches categorically is that God is love, and he loves every single person to distraction. That's the first thing I'd want you to know. The verse goes on to say this, for God loved the world so much that he gave his only son, that whoever believes in him, his son, will not perish, but will instead inherit eternal life. The second thing I would want you to know about all those other folks is that they desperately need Jesus to give them life. They are loved to distraction, and they need Jesus to give them life. About 500 years ago, the Christian church was a bit of a mess. The reason it was a bit of a mess is because some of the ideas about Jesus had started to veer from what the Bible teaches. So there were a group of people, they're known as reformers because they tried to reform the church. They started to say, you know what, let's go back to what the Bible says. The Latin phrase they used was sola scriptura. Let's just look at scripture alone. Let's just ask what the Bible says, so that we know what God thinks, specifically about salvation, specifically about people coming to into a personal and intimate relationship with God. And so as they started to talk and as they started to pray and as they studied scripture, they came up with some phrases that help us know what the Bible says. They're Latin phrases. The first one is sola gratia. It means grace alone, that salvation is a gift of God's grace. It is an unmerited favor. It is not a wage that you can earn. It's simply given to you. Sola fide means through faith alone. Faith is putting your trust in what we're going to hear about next. It's receiving the very lovely free offer that God has given to you. It's taking him up on that offer. It's a gift. You say yes, that's faith. Sola gratia, sola fide, solus Christus, in Christ alone. In Christ alone. And in Christ alone was really the center of what they were trying to teach. It was the center of the reform. It was, let's get back to Jesus Christ as the point. Now, Christus, solus Christus, can really point to two different things. One is that it is only Christ, and the other is that it is Christ alone. Those are different. Only Christ means that there is no one else by which someone can be saved. Christ alone means that it is Christ and nothing else added to him that can save. It is simply Christ. And let me just walk you through those two things from the Bible, because then you'll have a feel for how God feels about people. Let's talk about only Christ, first of all. No one else, nothing else can save you. I'm going to show you a couple Bible verses on my handy-dandy little screen here. Here's the first one from John's Gospel, chapter 14, verse 6. Jesus had told the disciples that he was going to die and he was going to go back to be with the Father, and he was going to go and prepare a place for them so they could follow him there. And they said, well, where is it? How do we get there? We don't know the way. His answer to that was this. Jesus answered, I am the way. I am the truth, and I am the life. If you want life, you're going to have to find it in me. He says it this way, no one comes to the Father except through me. That's pretty exclusive. He's saying it's only me. A little later, some of the disciples were taken before some religious leaders who were angry at them for healing a guy. Can you imagine being angry at someone for healing a guy? But they were. And in their explanation of Christ and his power, they said these amazing words. Salvation is found in no one else. For there is no other name under heaven given to mankind by which we must be saved. It's pretty clean cut. There's only one person that can save people. Now, there's other ideologies, other ideas, I understand that, but they all have the same problem. They are trying to provide another way for people to be saved. Let me give you some ideas. Here are some ideologies or some religions, some groups of people in the world. They are all presenting the same plan for people. I'm going to call it the to-do list plan. The to-do list. What they will tell you, in no uncertain terms, is that if you work through their to-do list and you follow through on their to-do list, then you will reach nirvana, or you'll find perfection, or you'll make it to heaven, or whatever the end goal is. So let me just explain them to you briefly. In Hinduism, you have the Eightfold Path. The Noble Eightfold Path. There are eight things you need to do right, and if you do these things right, then you will reach nirvana. They are the right view, the right resolve, the right speech, the right conduct, the right livelihood, the right effort, the right mindfulness, and the right union. You do all that right, and you might reach nirvana. Islam has the five pillars. You've probably heard of the five pillars of Islam. These are all to-do lists. They're just different to-do lists. The five pillars of Islam, the first is, they call it faith, but it's actually a declaration where you say there is only one God, his name is Allah, and his prophet is Muhammad. That's the first one. The second one is prayer, five times a day you need to pray. The third one is charity, giving to the poor. The fourth one is self-purification through fasting. You've heard of Ramadan, that's the fasting. And then the last one is a pilgrimage, a physical pilgrimage to the city of Mecca if you are physically able. If you do these five things, then you have a chance of going to heaven if you do them well. Judaism has the Ten Commandments. But then there's 603 other laws, other to-dos. So there's actually 613 to-dos in Judaism. In the Bible, it's called the law in both the Old Testament and the New Testament, but it's a list of 613 to-dos. Mormonism. I got on the official Mormon webpage. It's called lds.org. And I looked up salvation from sin, and this is how they describe it. To be cleansed from sin through the Savior's atonement, an individual must exercise faith in Jesus Christ. Just stop there. But they didn't stop there. They must repent, they must be baptized, and must receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. How do you receive the gift of the Holy Ghost? Those who have been baptized and have received the Holy Ghost through the proper priesthood authority, apparently certain people have to lay hands on you to receive the Holy Ghost, have been conditionally saved from sin. In this sense, salvation is conditional, depending on an individual's continuing in faithfulness, or to put it another way, enduring to the end and keeping the commandments. So now we're back to the 613. As long as you keep the commandments to the end, then you can be hoping to be saved. Jehovah's Witnesses. Their organization is called the Watchtower Society, the Watchtower Group, and they have a website. You can look it up. And on their website, asking for requirements for salvation, it says this: faith has to be exercised in Jesus Christ as the chief agent of salvation. Yes. Just stop there. But they didn't stop there. Then we are to persevere, they say. In order to persevere, there are four requirements. Requirement number one, accurate knowledge. You have to know Jehovah's Witness doctrine accurately. Requirement number two is to avoid debauchery. There's a long list of sins from the Bible that you're supposed to avoid, and then they add things to it like smoking, blood transfusions, boxing, participating in a raffle, voting, performing military or civic service, and a long list of things that you have to avoid. And requirement number three is Watchtower membership. You have to jump through some hoops to get that. And requirement number four is hitting the pavement and telling other people about your religion and your beliefs. You actually have to send in reports on how many people you've talked to, and you have to keep track of all that kind of stuff. And if you do that really well and persevere, then you have a chance of being part of a very small group that get to live in glory. Buddhism is a very diverse ideology. There's so many different ideas around it. One is stated this way, quote, if we meet a qualified Mahayana spiritual guide and put into practice everything he or she teaches, we shall definitely attain full enlightenment and become a conqueror Buddha, end quote. So we just have to find the right kind of guide, and then whatever they say, we have to do. That's our to-do list, whatever they say. Churchianity is the next one. There's thousands, there's millions of people in churchianity. In churchianity, there's kind of four big things that you have to do. You have to attend church. Every day the doors open is the kind of the phrase down here in the South. You have to attend church. You have to read your Bible consistently, preferably in the morning. You have to give money. And this is more relatively recent, but it seems to be becoming one of the big four. You have to adhere to a certain political bent. And what's fascinating is it depends which church you're in to determine which political bent you have to line up with. And there are people who think if you do these four things really well and really consistently, you'll be saved. But it's just another to-do list. That is as far removed from what Scripture teaches as Hinduism and Islam and Judaism and Mormonism and Jehovah's Witness. I put humanism on the list because humanism in its essence are usually people that are atheists, mostly. They don't believe that there's a God, but they believe in humanity and they love humans. And they want humanity to experience life in a much better way. And so they really invest in that. And they invest in things, they give and they get involved in social justice issues. And they mentor young people, and this way they're doing what would be salvation for them, which would be trying to make humanity stronger and better. In the 19th century, there was a mystic. His name was Ramakrishna, and he said, quote, God can be realized through all paths. All religions are true. The important thing is to reach the roof. You can reach it by stone stairs or by wooden stairs or bamboo steps or by a rope. You can also climb up by a bamboo pole, end quote. And this is the mindset of our contemporary culture. There's a lot of different choices, just choose one. But here's what the Bible teaches. The Bible teaches is no, these are all one side, it's a to-do list. And then the other side has this guy on it. His name is Jesus Christ. And this is not a to-do list, this is a done list. Because he has done the work necessary to rescue us on the cross. Jesus does not allow for all religions to be true because he said, and I've already read it to you, I am the way, I am the truth, I am the life. No one comes to the Father but through me. The to-do lists don't work. The Apostle Paul, talking to his young protege, Timothy, said it this way in 1 Timothy 2:5, for there is one God and one mediator between God and mankind, the man Christ Jesus. That's very exclusive. There's only one. Who gave himself as a ransom for all people. That's extremely inclusive. What he did on the cross was for everyone. I want you to imagine that you're on a large ship. And the ship is going down. You hit an iceberg or a rock or something, and the ship is going down. And the captain calls everyone on the deck. And so you run up to the deck, and you're waiting for the instructions. What do we do? What do we do? What do we do? And you're trying to find your life jacket, and you're putting it on. You're strapping it in. And then the announcement comes from the captain. Okay, here's the deal, everyone. The ship is going down. It'll be going down pretty quickly, so you need to listen quickly. All right. The closest land is an island 6,000 miles that way. You're on your own. Good luck. This will be a little terrifying. He said, but we do have one thing for you. If you see on the deck, we're providing you some bicycles. Bicycles. Feel free to choose whichever one you want. Over here, we have Hindu bicycles. They have 8 gears. And we have Muslim bicycles. They have 5 gears. We have some Jewish bicycles that have 613 gears. We have a Jehovah's Witness bicycle that has 4 gears and many other bicycles as well. Just choose your bike and pedal like crazy. Good luck. Someone may raise their hand and say, excuse me, but I'm not sure a bicycle is the right vehicle for the task at hand. I think a boat would be better. It's at that moment that you hear a voice behind you and you turn and there is Jesus in a boat. The name on the boat is the cross. And he just says, come on, I'll take you. Come on, I'll take you. The fact of the matter is the only way you're getting to that island is in the boat. It's the only way. And you can pick any one of those bicycles, but friend, bicycles don't work on water. It's the wrong vehicle for the task at hand. To-do lists are the wrong vehicle for the task at hand, getting you saved. Jesus is the only one that can do it. Only Christ. It's the first aspect of Solus Christus that I wanted to chat about. But this whole boat illustration kind of begs a question, and that is, can Jesus get me there in the boat? Is he sufficient? Just Jesus? Because if I'm like, putting all my hope in that one guy, is he capable of doing this? It's a very legitimate question. And that's the second aspect of Solus Christus. It's the sufficiency of Christ, that Christ alone is enough. I told you that the church was messed up 500 years or so ago. That happened actually hundreds of years before that. Some of the theologians started to steer the church away from Scripture. There was one theologian, his name was Anselm. And Anselm really lifted up Christ as the God-man, which was true and good. But he didn't really talk about how the work of Christ on the cross is applied to us as individuals. So there was a vacuum in the church's theology in that area because he was the church theologian. A number of years later, a guy, Thomas Aquinas came along, and he filled in that vacuum. And let me show you what he said. In his great book, Summa Theologica, Thomas Aquinas said, Christ's passion, that's another way of saying the cross, his work on the cross, Christ's passion works its effects in them to whom it is applied. How? Through faith. Yes! Just put a period right there. Just stop. Because that's true. This is how the Bible teaches. It is applied through faith. It is taking him up on his very kind offer. Sola fide, but that's not where he stopped. He didn't put a period there. He put a comma there. Through faith and, add to that, charity, and add to that, the sacraments of the faith. The sacraments of the faith at this time were penance, the mass. Indulgences were added to the list. Other things were added to the list. So there was all these things you had to do on top of Jesus to be saved. And this is what the reformers said, no. Because they went back to scripture and they saw that it truly was Christ alone. One reformer, his name was Ulrich Zwingli, wrote a work called The First Zurich Disputation, and here's what he said. We know from the Old and New Testaments of God that our only comforter, only redeemer, only savior, and only mediator with God is Jesus Christ, in whom and through whom alone we can obtain grace, help, and salvation, and besides from no other being in heaven or on earth. The reformers taught us that Christ is sufficient. Christ alone is all you need to save you. Why did they believe this so strongly? Because they'd read their Bibles. Scripture is categorically clear that the work of Christ on the cross is sufficient for salvation. Let me just walk you through a few examples. In the book of Hebrews chapter 9, verse 12, it said, He, this is Jesus, did not enter the most holy place. This is heaven it's talking about. He did not enter the most holy place by means of the blood of goats and calves like the Old Testament sacrifices, but instead, he entered the most holy place once for all by his own blood, speaking here of his finished work on the cross, thus obtaining, listen, eternal redemption. This is fascinating. One solitary act, the cross of Jesus Christ, purchased something that lasts forever. That sounds fairly sufficient to me. If that one act can last forever, I don't think you need to add anything to it. It sounds like that one act is enough. Galatians chapter 2, verse 21. I do not set aside the grace of God, for if righteousness, right standing before God, being right with God, could be gained through to-do lists, through the law, then Christ died for nothing. Think about it. If you could earn salvation by a to-do list, any of the to-do lists I've walked through, if any of them would work, do you really think God would have sent his son to die? No, he would have said, do this list. This will work for you. But he didn't. He sent his son to die. Why? Because he knew the list couldn't work. But his death was sufficient. We might say, I just want to add one little thing. I just want to do something. I want to be part of this process. I want to do one little thing. Well, some people came to one of the churches that Paul planted in Galatia, and they were teaching them that. Yes, Jesus is fine, but add to that circumcision, because you need to become Jewish too. Then you're a true believer, and then you'll really go to heaven. This is how Paul responded to that. Mark my words, I, Paul, tell you that if you let yourselves be circumcised, this is the one thing we're going to add, Christ will be of no value to you at all. Wow. Again, I declare to every man who lets himself be circumcised that he is obligated to obey the whole law. So if you want to add one, just go ahead and try and do all 613. You who are trying to be justified by the law have been alienated from Christ. You have fallen away from grace. You are moving away from the one provision that can rescue you. Don't add anything to Christ. It's kind of like you're moving towards the boat. And as you go towards the boat and Jesus is saying, come on, get in, and you're thinking about it. Right before you get in, you grab one of the bikes and you throw it over your shoulders and you start getting into the boat. And Jesus is like, what are you doing? And you're like, I'm coming with you, Jesus. He said, what's the bike for? Well, just in case. Just in case what? Just in case you can't get me there. No. Either get in the boat, no bike, or try the bike, but there will be no bikes in my boat. It's me. Me alone. Trust me or don't. Jesus draws a very clear line. Very clear line. A couple more. 2 Corinthians 5:21, the Apostle Paul says, God made him, this is Christ, who had no sin. He was sinless. He was perfect. He was fully God, fully man, but he never sinned. It's why he was able to die for us. But God made him sin. He took upon himself all of our sin. He became sin for us. He did this for us because of his deep love for us. So that, this is the purpose clause, in him, in Christ. It doesn't say in Islam or in Hinduism or in Mormonism. It says in Christ, we might become the righteousness of God. There is no improving on the righteousness of God. The righteousness of God is top shelf. It is the righteousness of God. And because of this amazing transaction, when we put our trust in Jesus Christ, he gets our sin, we get God's righteousness. We become God's righteousness. Friends, if the cross is able to do that, what would you possibly add to it? Romans chapter 8, last one. Therefore, there is now, say it with me, no condemnation. Oh, what beautiful words. There is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. The Bible keeps coming back to him. He's the point. Because through Christ Jesus, the law of the Spirit who gives life, there it is, life, has set you free from the law of sin and death. For what the law was powerless to do, what was the to-do list? Powerless to do? It was powerless to get you to a place of no condemnation. No to-do list can get you to a place of no condemnation. What the law, the to-do list was powerless to do because it was weakened by the flesh, God did. Done. By sending his own son in the likeness of sinful flesh to be a sin offering. It's the cross. And listen to this. So he condemned sin in the flesh. Whose sin? Your sin. My sin. Your sin. He condemned your sin, my sin, our sin in the flesh. Whose flesh? The flesh of Christ. Christ absorbed our condemnation on the cross so that we would be not condemned in him. Phew. That's pretty thorough. You don't need anything else. Only Christ, Christ alone. That's what the Bible teaches. On our sabbatical this summer, my wife Libby and I were driving through Salt Lake City, and so we decided to spend a night there and then decided to spend a day touring the Mormon temple grounds. Now, we weren't allowed in the temple, because you have to be a part of the Mormon church to go in the actual temple. But we were able to go into the tabernacle and we heard a beautiful organ recital in the tabernacle, incredible pipe organ in that place. And then we got a tour and there were two young ladies that gave us this tour. And I got to hear the story they're telling people. And I was blown away. I hadn't heard it before. Here's how the story goes. We were sitting there in our group listening to these two young women tell us what happened. What happened, they said, was that the church got off to a pretty good start. And as long as the 12 apostles were around, there was power in the early church. But when the apostles died, the power died with them. And thus, the gospel died with them, and the church died as well. Number of centuries later, an angel by the name of Moroni came to a man in America called Joseph Smith, and he brought him some gold plates, and he told him, you need to set it up like this. You need apostles. Once you get apostles again, there'll be power again, and then you can start the church again, and the gospel can be brought back to life. And so Joseph Smith started the Mormon church, and now we have the true church and the true gospel after all those centuries of nothing. And I sat there thinking, seriously? We just wiped out 1,800 years of church history. We wiped out 1,800 years of people's lives being radically transformed, of people's marriages being restored, of people finding life, of churches banding together and coming alongside deeply wounded people and loving them and caring for them. Really? All that just went away? We continue to have different conversations. We got to the end of the day and we're walking out, we're leaving, and a young woman comes up to me and she says, hey, where are you guys from? And we said, we're from Texas. She said, oh, well, we have a temple in San Antonio. You should go and see the temple in San Antonio. And I said, ma'am, I'm not going to the temple in San Antonio. And she said, well, why not? I said, because I have Jesus. I have Christ, it's all I need. I don't need any of the rest of this stuff. And I talked a little bit. And her response to me was, well, I will pray for you that you will see the truth. Yeah. And I said, well, I will pray for you that you will see the truth. And then I felt Libby's hand grab me and... I was grieved, I was deeply grieved. And the reason I was grieved was because this young woman really believed this. And I got up the next morning and I was reading in Galatians chapter 1, where Paul said, I am astonished that you are so quickly deserting the one who called you to live in the grace of Christ and are turning to a different gospel, which is really no gospel at all. Evidently, some people are throwing you into confusion and are trying to pervert the gospel of Christ. Listen to this. But even if we or an angel from heaven, Moroni, the angel, is on every temple, every Mormon temple around the world. Moroni is up there on the top of it, big golden angel. He's the one that brought this gospel. If any angel from heaven should preach a gospel other than the one we preach to you, let them be under God's curse. Strong words. You see, Paul protected the gospel, the truth, because it's the only way. It's the only way. My mother-in-law, Dottie, has come to live with us. We're so excited. We flew her back from Wisconsin last night, so she had our first night in her home. She's been a widow for a couple of years now, and she's been going from one kid's house to the next, so it's our turn. We get her for a few months. Very wise. She's doing winter in Dallas. This was a good choice. Her first winter, she went to her son's house in Anchorage, Alaska. But she figured it out this time. No, we're thrilled to have her. And just thinking about her this morning and thinking about this, this whole question and the answer that I wanted to give, I was reminded of her story. As a young woman, just desperate for life. Her life was just dead, and she knew it. Desperate for life. And so she went to the library at Carroll College in Waukesha, Wisconsin. And she started checking out books on the great religions of the world. And she started reading and studying. She's brilliant, and she absorbed everyone, trying everyone, thinking, maybe this is it, maybe this is it, realizing it's just a to-do list, it doesn't work, and went back and started the next one and tried and started all over, and she's just working through the religions of the world. One to-do list after another, after another, after another. No, 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 no. Gave up. Gave up. Got married, started to have kids, family business. Numbing her pain. Marriage drifts apart, gets separated, heading towards divorce. Dead. And then one night she's sitting on her back porch. She has an old black and white TV with the old rabbit ears. Remember these things where you go, okay, right there, right there, right there. The millennials are looking at me like, what is he talking? Rabbit ears? What? Ask an old folk, they'll tell you about it. She got the TV to work, and a preacher from the South by the name of Billy Graham came on the screen.
You know what he said? I mean, I wasn't watching the program, but I know what he said, because he just said the same thing every time.
Because there's only one thing to say. There's this guy. His name is Jesus. He was God and he was man. He lived a perfect life. He voluntarily sacrificed himself, and in doing so did everything necessary for you to have life. He came back to life, and now he calls you into a relationship. Will you say yes to him? It's the gospel. And Dottie said, yes. She took him up on his very kind offer. And he transformed her life. Radically.
Her husband, Hubert, met Christ at a Christian businessman's luncheon about the same time. They got together to talk about ending their marriage. And Hugh said, well, first of all, I need to tell you something. I've become a Christian. She's like, no way, me too. Well, let's talk about this. They ended up being married over 60 years. Yeah.
Because God rescued their marriage, rescued their family. All their kids became believers. They're walking with Christ. He does this. He's been doing it. He's been doing it contrary to what some people will tell you for 2,000 years. And he still is today. At the end of the day, what I want to tell you about the people that don't believe what I believe is that God is passionately in love with them
and that they desperately need Jesus to give them life.
I'm going to pray. Pray with me, please. Our Lord, thank you for your truth. And I know that in a culture where we're trying to figure out how to make all our ideas work together, this is a little countercultural because you're saying, no, it's just me or nothing. And so even as I speak these words, I sense how countercultural they are, but they're true. And so we say them and we relish them and we soak in them, and we thank you for the good news. And Lord, thank you for your love. Thank you for the life that you've given us in Christ. And we want to sing of that together. We want to celebrate it. I give this time to you, and I pray it in Jesus' name. Amen.